Hello and welcome everyone to School Synergy session. We will start in 2-3 minutes. Just hold on, people are joining. Good afternoon, everyone. Okay, people are still joining. So welcome to yet another session of School Synergy Workshop Series. We had established this series in 2018 and face-to-face workshops with several teachers that were around the schools in TIS itself. And the main intention of these workshops is to provide a common space for university educators as well as teachers to exchange ideas, build on each other ideas, and also share ideas which can be directly implemented in the practice, and basically trying out a few innovative ideas here together. So we have been doing it for a long time. Since August, we have been doing this online every week, and the response has been very encouraging for us, and we hope that you all continue to join these School Synergy workshop series in the future. So today, I'm very happy to introduce my friend and colleague, Shweta Nayak, whom I have known for a very long time, since I was doing my PhD at Humi Baba Center. And she has also been working at Humi Baba Center for Science Education, Mumbai, in Mathematics Education Research Group since many years. She has received her PhD in Mathematics Education from University of Michigan, USA, under Deborah Ball, and was also an adjunct faculty at University of Northern Colorado from 2018 to 19. And she has done her master's from Pune University and bachelor's in mathematics from Mumbai University. She has a very diverse teaching and professional experience. She has worked with several, I would say, organization, Central Board of Secondary Education, Zonal Institute of Education Technology, KVs, St. Xavier's Institute of Education, and even with ourselves. She has been an active participant in the proportional reasoning module that we have built in our CLICS initiative, which is also uploaded on CLICS OER. She has taught at master's level, PhD students, and even in schools. So we are fortunate today to have her with us to share some ideas about area measurement and conservation. So looking forward to learn from you, Shweta. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Ruchi. That was very kind of you to say those nice words. And yes, Ruchi and I have been friends for now, I don't know, maybe more than a decade, of course. So it has been nice. What I will be doing today, maybe Ruchi, for Ruchi, there might not be many new things because she has been part of the maths lab also that Homi Baba Center has. But hopefully the way I have tied them together might be something that is useful. So good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much for joining on Saturday. And it's nice to meet in this format, online format. And I'm getting comfortable with this mode. So it's nice to meet you, big number in this mode. So can I share my screen, Ruchi?
Sure, please go ahead.
So as the topic says, understanding area measurement and conservation activity mode. See, the picture you see in the background is from one of our maths laboratory wall. And interestingly, all these things that you see, the colorful things, are made by one of the TISS MA education student. She was doing internship with us, so during that time. So it's interesting how things are getting used and getting connected. So I'll just go right into the topic, because I have made some ambitious plan of doing three things with you. So hopefully we'll reach there. If you haven't, please catch some like a paper, A4 size paper with you. Possibly if people need scissors and pen, pencil, whatever, if you want to do some work in some of the activities. So if you haven't, just get those things with you and we'll begin. I think one of the question is, what is area? See, when we ask students what is area, you will often hear saying that it's length into breadth. So for example, area of rectangle has been emphasized so much that when you ask area, they just end up giving formula. So what is area? Area is a property, or it's a formula, what it is? So we are going to come back to this question at the end. And what I'm going to do is, we are going to make sense of what area measurement is through three activities. And some of those activities might be something that you have already seen or used in some other context. But here we will only focus on the area aspect of those activities. So the first activity is going to be a tangram. The second activity is actually geo board, and the tangrams is written. And the third is missing area. So we are going to do three things. Understand unit for area measurement, understand convention for area measurement, and then understand conservation of area, which is, so I have chosen this idea based on what I have understood about students' work in area measurement, and where they most end up doing alternative or different kinds of thinking rather than what is expected. So let's move ahead. So this is a familiar picture for many of you, most math teachers. This is tangram pieces, and it's a horse in tangram. You know, tangram can make like infinite number of, people say 440, but also there are many, many shapes that you can make. So we are going to try and make a tangram. So I would ask all of you to get something like an A4 size paper. I don't know whether you can see this paper. So yeah, so something of this size, A4, or if you have a square, then take a square paper. So let's begin. If you have an A4 sheet, then take out a square sheet from it, so you know how to do it. So if you fold it like this, it's also shown in the picture. And then you cut this extra part. We don't need this extra part. So you get a square sheet from it. So what I'm going to do here is, because it's an online mode, every stage I'm going to wait for 30 seconds or so, and then I'm going to move on. And if you need more time, just type it into chat window, and Ruchi, Dr. Ruchi would let me know. Okay, Dr. Ruchi, that would be okay, isn't it?
Sure, yeah, definitely. Please put on your videos if you are doing with us side by side. We can also watch and know how you're doing. Yeah. If you want to put on your video, you are welcome to do so.
Yeah, that I think is a great idea. If they can switch on their videos, you could also see. And if the picture is not clear, see here again that you have an A4 sheet, and it's folded and made into this part. The above part is square, and this extra part, when you remove this extra part, I'm also going to do it here and also show in the pictures. So, okay, I'm assuming that everyone has this square sheet, or those who have began with square sheet, they don't need to do this step. So let's move on. So now you have this square, and what I want from this is two congruent triangles from the square. So the meaning of congruent is that if you superimpose them on each other, they should match exactly, meaning all angles and all sides are exactly same, also the orientation. So when angles are same, the orientation is going to be same. So the basically thing is that if they superimpose like this, then they're congruent. And cut those two things, so you will get two big triangles. So I'm going to wait for 30 seconds here again. It would be a good idea to actually do this, even if you're thinking that you will just watch it and not do, because there might be some, not might be, there are some activities where you'll have to handle these pieces and give me some responses. So if you're planning just to watch, I would still suggest that change your mind. grab a paper and start getting things folded and packed. So you have two pieces of paper. Each of them is a triangle, and those two are congruent to each other, which means that if I superimpose, they should match exactly. I'm going to go move ahead. There are some steps for which I'll give a little longer time. So this is what you have. So now keep one piece down and just take one of the pieces in your hand, one of the triangles in your hand, and you can see in the picture how they are made into, again, two congruent right angle triangles. So how would you do that? So you have this one piece. Then what would you do to get two right angle triangle congruent pieces? So basically, I'm using a waste paper, so one-sided. And then I just folded it like that. So I've got right angle here. I've got right angle here. And they are congruent to each other because they are superimposed. And cut these two. So far you have three pieces, one big triangle and two small triangle, and all are triangles. So if you have three pieces, forget about that extra rectangle piece. Just, we are not going to use it. Maybe just throw it away. Just these three pieces.
The first triangles that we made, that would also be congruent right triangles, right?
So the first set of triangles that we made were like this from square. So there were two set of right congruent triangles. Then we took one of it. I'll go back in the presentation. So this is where we started. We got a square sheet. Then we folded a square sheet to get two congruent right angle triangles. You can see the right angle is the angle of square. Both angles of squares will be right angle. And then one of the triangle I've preserved as it is, and the other triangle I'm making two congruent right angle triangles from it. So now you have three, at this stage you should have three pieces. I'm gonna go move ahead. People who are behind can just let us know if we need to wait, okay? So now these two pieces I'm just going to keep aside, and the longer rectangle triangle, what I want to know is that what I want to find out is the midpoint of the longest side of the triangle. So how would you find the midpoint of the longest side of the triangle? Yeah, you can do it on your paper.
You can show it. If you want to unmute, you can speak also.
Yeah. So this
Sangeeta ma'am here is showing. Okay. Can you see?
Yeah.
The gallery view.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, Sangeeta ma'am, that's how you have to do.
I can see.
Rama Kapoor, your video is on, but I think you are in auto. I'm not sure if you want to put the video on or not.
Okay. Were you saying something for me?
No, please go ahead.
So this is the longest side. That is the first part of the activity. This is the longest side. And to find the midpoint, we are just going to fold this two and get a midpoint. So we got midpoint. So that is the step. I think everybody's there. Let's move on. Now you have to take this vertex. The text is also written on the slide. Text this vertex opposite to the longest side and put that vertex on the midpoint that you just found like this. And then fold this. Try to do it as exactly as you can. You don't have to hold it in the air. You can put it on the desk and do it. So yeah. And cut these two pieces. So basically you will get this small triangle. And do you know what this shape is?
Trapezium.
Trapezium.
It's a trapezium. So we get one more triangle and a trapezium. Yeah. Yeah. So I think the best way to cut is what many of you are doing is by actually using scale and just. And I like.
We need to cut the smaller triangle from this now.
Yes, yes. So see the way I did. So this was the original. Now I've cut it. So we are cutting on the fold. So we are doing paper folding, but also cutting. Maybe I should have called it as folding and cutting. Yeah, so this is the way. So if you have four pieces, you are on right track. You have three triangles and one trapeze. Okay, yeah, so let's move on. So this is the shapes you should have so far. Sorry, I've changed the paper image here because the blue paper images were not working for the next shapes. So these ones I've taken from the internet, the references I've given at the end. So you have three triangles and one trapezium, okay? So these shapes you should have so far. Let's move on. Now make two congruent trapeziums from this one big trapezium. How would you do that? You want congruent again. Yeah, great job, yeah. So, and again, I'm going to cut on the folds, do the same thing. If people don't want to cut, then there's a next step where you can cut, but you can also cut it. Okay, so I'm just gonna wait for 10 seconds and then. Yeah, so let's move ahead. So from the half of this trapezium, in this picture, it's not cut. From the half of this trapezium, take I need a square and a small triangle. So how would you get it? A square and a small triangle.
Fold it here, ma'am, exactly.
Yes.
Like this.
Saraswati madam, mm-hmm. Yes. I cannot say everybody's name, but.
Shravanti.
Yeah. So, and you're also using a colored paper. Thank you. So, yeah.
Ma'am, this activity is there in this cool mat course, ma'am.
Yes, yes, correct.
I have enrolled myself, so I already did.
Okay, great.
And the thick red thing. Okay.
Yeah,
thank you. That's nice to know. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
So, I'm going to cut this. So you have two, one square and one triangle. So far now you have how many pieces? Six pieces. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Okay. Now just take the last trapezium. I'm just going to go ahead because we have a few more things to do. Yeah. So this is everyone still has one piece of this one trapezium. Yeah. If you haven't, you have messed it up now. So now you'll have to watch. So this is little trickier. I need one parallelogram and one triangle from this. Yeah. So how would you fold it? So I know that someone would call rectangle also parallelogram or square also, but I need a typical kaju katli shape of parallelogram. So. Yes, I can see somebody got it, but their full video hasn't come yet. Okay, so look at this, the way I'm doing. Look at this vertex. Take this vertex and fold it to its opposite vertex. So like this. Okay, I'm just gonna also show the image. Yeah.
Do we cut it?
Yes. So now you got your 7-piece tangrams. So there is also a 5-piece tangram. We are working on 7-piece today. So the idea, there are several activities that you could do on this. And generally what we do at HBCC is also very little different than what I'm planning to do. But let's just see whether everyone has this 7 shapes, okay? So you can see on the screen, you have almost 5 triangles. Two big triangles, then
Six triangles.
Yeah, six triangles. One of my triangle, yeah. Two big triangles, two small triangles, one middle-sized triangle, one square, and one parallelogram.
Parallelogram.
Yeah, and this, all shapes we got from the square that we began with. So generally, we spend a lot of time on what I'm going to ask you to do next, but here we'll spend a little less time. And maybe Saraswati ma'am is not allowed to answer this question. Is to arrange these pieces back to the square that you started. So can you assemble all these pieces? You remember that we started with a square. So just assemble them. And of course, this is not our main, not related to area activity, but we need this to do some area activity. See, one of the ways you can do is you can remember, try to recall how you did it. So what you did, sort of. Other way is to treat it as a jigsaw puzzle. See which side align on which side. Okay, I see smiles on some faces, so. Yeah. So if everybody has just 7 pieces, I'm going to go ahead unless someone wants to show their solution. So you remember first we had a square and we made 2 congruent triangles. Then one of the triangle we again made into 2 triangles. No? Then we had a trapezium and triangle on the other side. Okay. So let's move ahead. I'm just going to show you how it sort of assembles. So look at this figure. I've also numbered the pieces for the reasons that I want to use this. So just if you closely tie them together, you'll get a square. So 1 and 2, you have 2 congruent triangles. 5 and 6 are again pair of congruent triangles. 4 is square, 7 is parallelogram, and 3 is the triangle. And this way you can actually ask students to even make a rectangle, triangle, and all those shapes are possible. Triangle is one of the challenging one to do. Rectangle is easier, you can make it from this shape only. So yeah, you have a set of tangrams and you already have one activity that assemble a square. So can someone just describe these pieces in terms like a geometric description, what these pieces are one by one? So I'll do a piece number 1 and then people can follow. So piece 1 is basically a right angle triangle and it also has 2 sides. So it's isoscalene right angle triangle, 2 sides same. Can someone describe triangle 2? It's actually exactly same, so maybe not 2, because 2 is congruent to 1. So can someone describe triangle 3?
Yes.
Equilateral?
Yeah. Triangle. It's right angle also and equilateral also.
You have the piece in your hand. Can you check whether it's equilateral?
If is it possible equilateral and right triangle?
No, it's not.
Say that again.
It's basically right angle triangle.
Is it possible to have equilateral and right triangle? Someone is saying right angle and equilateral both.
So there are 2 questions here. The one that I asked was whether the triangle has a longest side. If it has a longest side, then can it be equilateral? That is what I asked. There is another question that if you know one of the angle is 90 degrees of the triangle, so can it be an equilateral triangle?
No. norm.
Because if equilateral triangle means the three sides and three angles are equal, and three angles cannot be 90 degrees. So if one of the angle is 90 degree, then we know for sure that it is not an equilateral triangle. And therefore, we also know that all three sides are not same. And the question that I asked, if one of the side is the longest side, which means sides are not equal, so it's not equilateral. So who will describe triangle 3?
Ma'am, it's isosceles.
Isosceles, right.
Isosceles and right angle, ma'am. Great. Two sides are measured are 10 centimeters. The longest side is 15, I believe. Something like
okay, that. So we are not going into centimeters because...
Yeah, but I just measured it for 5 years. Okay,
fine, yeah. Number 4?
It's a square, ma'am.
It's a square, so there is nothing to say more. Number 5 and 6, can someone describe? So those are again...
In right angle, the isosceles triangle.
Yes, Himani. Yeah. And number 7?
It's a
parallelogram.
So this is what we got as 7 pieces and this is their geometric description. Now let's get back to the topic of today. So what I'm telling you that use number piece 5. Can you also mark these numbers accordingly? So use piece 5 as your unit now.
Yeah.
And find out the area of the entire square. So, Saraswati ma'am, even though you have used something like 10 centimeters and all, you just keep that aside for this moment. Use unit 5 as your, piece 5 as your unit and tell me the area in terms of shape 5 of the square. And those who want to try something else, they can also try number 7.
16.
Yeah, so with 5, so how will you say that area? How will you say? We generally say 16 square units. How will you say in this context?
16 dot triangular unit.
Yeah. 16, let's call it as 5 piece. So 16 5 pieces is the area of the of this square. Is that what everyone got, 16? And how do you know that it's 16? Yeah, I'm just trying to cover everyone. So I know somebody gave answer and I can't see that person, but I'm just waiting for others to get it. Yeah.
You can unmute and speak if you want to. Others also.
Yeah, please do so. So, and somebody said that it is 16, 5 pieces is the area of the square. So I'm using 5 pieces as a unit for area here because that is what we are using as a unit. So can someone just elaborate how it is? What does it mean 16 5 pieces area? Can someone at least say that? What does that mean?
Number 5, it's a half of the parallelogram number 6.
Okay. So there are 2 5s in
6. There are 3, 5 and 6, there are 3 units and 1 that is also, in 7 also we have 2 parts of number 5, equal parts.
Okay.
So this is half, 1/4 part, 5, 6 and half part of 7, this is 1/4 part.
Correct.
So totally 6.
Thank you so much, sir. I can't see your name, but yeah, thank you. So what he did is he actually took the piece 5 and he is measuring entire area using that. So when he put that piece 5 on piece 6, he saw 2 of 5s fit on 6. So 2 five pieces fit on 6. 3 is exactly like 5. So there you are 4 5 pieces. Number 4 will have again 2 5 pieces. Number 7 will have 2 5 pieces. And 1 will have 4 and 2 will have 4. So if you add these, you get 16 5 pieces as the area of the square. So generally the language we use is 16 square units. So now you can see what it means sort of. 16 5 pieces is the area meaning 16 5 pieces in number 16 could fit into this area. And 16 square units would mean that 16 square units were fitted into this area. And so what is the meaning of square unit? We'll see in a bit. So anybody did with piece number 7? So what's happening with piece number 7? Now you already know that how many 5s fit into piece number 7? 2. So what will happen when you measure the entire square using 7? How many 7s will fit?
1, 2, 3, 4.
Basically half of it.
Will it be 14?
8.
Half of it, yeah. See, the logic I was, maybe you can tell me how you got 14.
11.
Because
7. 7? 8.
See, I was using the logic that if 7.
8 pieces.
8 pieces. Somebody saying 8 pieces. So I also think 7.
Two triangles will have 2 of 7 pieces, ma'am.
7.
Yeah.
And the high end 7 including will be one big piece, ma'am, again.
I think there is confusion of two numbers. There is a number 7 triangle and some people are saying that the 7 can be fit into 7 times. So let me just clarify. So number 7 triangle, we already found out that number 5 piece can fit into 16 times into this entire square. Everybody agrees this so far? Yeah. Now we know that the number 7 piece of triangle, in that your number 5 can fit twice. Okay. So is that unit is twice of number 5. Okay. So when you measure the same area using the little bigger unit, which is actually exactly double unit of your earlier unit, what is going to happen to the area? It's going to become 8 7 pieces. With number 5, it was 16 5 pieces. So it will become 8 7 pieces. It is like if I ask you if there is a 4 chapatis and I ask you how many chapatis are there, you said 4 chapatis. If I ask you how many pairs of chapatis are there, you will say 2 pairs. Because the unit has now become bigger, so your count is going to become smaller. And that is exactly. And like someone else was saying, again I couldn't see their names, someone else also said the number, the other way is actually count, like actually repeat and count, which we would like our students to do a lot, is that take the 7 piece and see in number 1 piece it fits twice, in number 2 piece it fits twice, so you saw 4. 3 and 5 together will make 7 piece, so that is 5 and 6. And again 7 and 4, how would you figure out it makes the piece number 7? That you have to figure it out, how to arrange it. Yeah. But you know that in number 4, 5 pieces were fitting 2 times. So that is exactly like 7. And number 6, 5 pieces were fitting 2 times. So that is exactly like 7. So we are doing a lot of manipulations around area here. Yeah. And I can see some of you are actually waving your hands and trying to do that. So good. So the point I was trying to make here was that what we, when we measure area, what we are measuring is a region. So when you ask someone, how do we measure area? And someone responds that length into breadth, it doesn't make sense. I know it's a formula for rectangle, but it doesn't make sense because you cannot measure area using any length. So to measure length, we use scale, which is a length. So you can measure length using length. You can measure area using area. And you can measure volume using volume. So for example, if you have to find out, you have a dibba at home and you want to find out how many glasses of something fill into it, you actually, so you decide a unit which has a volume and then you measure what is the total volume. So you cannot measure volume using sides. You cannot measure area using sides. You need another area. Now the question is what area I should use. Like in the earlier examples, I use 5-piece area and measured the area 16 5 pieces. Someone else use 7. Someone might decide to use number 1 as a unit. And what we might get is we'll get different measures, like different area as a number for this figure because the unit that we used is different. So there is a standardization of unit. And what is the standardization? That a square, if it has one side, which means all 4 sides are one unit, then the area of that square is 1 square unit. So this is a convention. So the length into breadth rule for rectangle or side of a square rule for square has come because of this convention. So when you constantly apply this convention, you start seeing the pattern. You see the pattern that rectangle may, what is happening, Baba? Ki you're repeating, so that is exactly equal to that length of this side when you repeat these squares. And this count is exactly same as the length of the breadth. And that is why the formula length into breadth. It's not the other way. it's not that this area of the square on the slide which you see is one because its side is one and breadth is one. No, this is what we assumed because we wanted, we knew that area could be measured using area. So mathematicians decided to assume that this area is one. And therefore we derived all the formula based on this. So if you decide to assume something else about this, then your formulas will also change. And that is okay for mathematicians as long as you are consistent in that construction of your formulas. So if you have any questions at this regard, just please put down them in the chat or unmute and ask also. So I'm going to wait for like 20 seconds and move on because we are merging into the next. Yes, somebody is speaking.
Hello.
So I think I'll move on.
Good afternoon, ma'am. May I?
I think somebody is speaking.
Yes, yes. Please.
May I ask you a question, ma'am?
Yes.
Sure.
No, ma'am. See, because as you are explaining this about like a region to measure a region, we use a region. You know, this is something very astounding to me at present because all this while, all these years, since we have been like, for example, area of a square, as you said, we will normally ask our students that this is the length, okay, and you find the area of the square. So and conventionally we teach them length into length, isn't it? Similarly for rectangle or for volume of a cube, we say length cube, isn't it? So where are we going wrong here then, ma'am, and how do we rectify it?
Thank you so much for your question. It's not about being wrong and right. Of course, there are curriculums where the starting points are not formula. There are many curriculums that you'll find where the starting point is not at all formula, but something that we'll do as a next activity. So I won't talk much about it. But the point of rectification is, I think you feel that when students reach to grade 7 and then there are like 20 formulas for surface area, for volume, and then you don't see when there is a total surface area, this understanding of why total surface area has to add those things. Because that concept of area is not developed. What students have been doing is they're learning to use a formula, which is a completely different skill. Do you agree with me?
Yes,
so
ma'am.
How to use a formula is a different skill, whereas developing a sense of area is a different thing. So the emphasis is on the former, that how to use a formula, which is which is not only in area. It happens in mathematics teaching at various places.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
I don't think it's teachers' fault entirely because it's also the way textbooks have been written.
Correct.
So there are alternative curriculums where the starting points are different. The other example that you could use with your students is the area of the house.
Okay.
What do we mean when I say area of my house is 510 square feet or 1020 square feet? What do you mean by that? How do you know that 1020 square feet is a larger house than 512? Because when I say square feet, what I'm using is a square with 1 feet of dimension.
Yes.
So if you take actually that Purana tile used to be 1 feet by 1 feet.
Yes,
nowadays
yes.
It doesn't exist. They want the white granite and other stuff. But 1 feet by 1 feet, if you actually measure, so 512 of those should fit into your house.
Yes.
Or 1,000 of those have to fit into your house. And that is how we know that 1,000 square feet is bigger than 512 feet.
Okay.
Because the unit of measurement is same. So this could be a point where you could bring how to measure areas of your classroom, for example, by deciding some unit and repeatedly. So to get a sense of what area is.
Okay.
So thank you so much for that question.
Thank you.
Yes, definitely.
I think it's an important question because we have been teaching that way for a very long time. And I think it is a very useful thing to start using area for measurement of area itself.
Yeah, I think the phrase that Ruchi uses is very important. Not learning to use formula of the area, but being able to measure the area. I think that is the distinction. So let's see how.
One thing I want to share.
When we don't know formula, yes.
This is also becomes the difficult whether we are talking about area of a triangle, area of a square, area of a rectangle. Is it true? Should not be say area of a rectangular region, area of a triangular region, area of a circular region. So that also sometimes becomes a However, conventionally, we are using area of a triangle. And you are also using, when you were using those pieces of cardboard and all that, they are triangle. But they are not triangle, they are triangular. Lamina,
so you are hitting on a very important part of mathematics. It's not only about terminology, but we know that rectangle, triangle, square are all two-dimensional figures. So what does it mean to have a rectangle and actually measure? So rectangular region. But unfortunately, we might not have. So there needs to be some understanding of, when I say rectangle here, it means rectangular region. Because I don't think that kind of change, because that kind of change would require a very different kinds of textbook, even from grade two, where we introduce. So we give a point definition and we give picture of point in the textbook. So that those all things will have to change. Are you getting the point?
I just, because we are talking with the teachers, that's why I raised.
No. I think it's a very important point, and I'm saying that the teacher should, in fact, sometimes find a way to even communicate this to students at maybe higher grades. But I was saying that even though it's an excellent point, a curriculum won't be able to do justice to this. That is what I was trying to say. Not that it is not. It's a very important point, in fact. And many mathematic educators, many mathematicians became math educators, researchers, for this point, that how this language is diluting the whole idea of mathematics. But I hope everyone got the point sir was saying. Sir is saying that there are 2D figures which we cannot even hold in our hands. These are two-dimensional. The only thing we can hold in our hand is three-dimensional figures. And when we say that area of rectangle, what does that even mean? Because it's just a 2D boundary. But what we mean by the inside region of that rectangular piece. So he's saying the correct usage is rectangular region. And that is perfectly right. But we have been using it as rectangle square. But when you say rectangle, it just means those four boundary. It doesn't include the interior area at this moment. Unless you say region.
So there is also this issue of, how do you refer to the, all the geometric concepts in that sense are idealized. And they are not present in the concrete or real world. But we have to talk about it. We have to engage students in learning about it. So we have to start somewhere with perhaps the concrete and gradually make them develop the sense of this abstraction and what these terminologies also refer to. Increasingly refine the terminologies as they go to higher grades, perhaps.
Yeah. So I think
we may also use area bounded by triangle, area bounded by rectangle, area bounded by circle. That can also be used.
I think if you could communicate to your student, this point, it's excellent. But when you communicate this, make space where they can ask questions whether they have understood or not. But if you could have this communication and successful, I think it's an excellent pedagogical achievement. So yes. I'm not going to talk about this. It's just now you can measure the area with a unit. So I'm going to move ahead. And if still there are some questions, please write down in the chat. We might take them back at the end or something. So now we are going to a mode where earlier, 3-4 minutes ago, one ma'am spoke. So on that line, the starting point is not formula. So let's calculate the areas. Don't use any formula. So take a minute and calculate. And maybe one of you can, you cannot use any formula, okay? I'll tell you some information about the dots there. They're all equidistant, horizontally and vertically. The distance is 1 unit.
2 square meters.
So horizontal distance is also 1 unit. Vertical distance is also 1 unit. Of course, the diagonal distance will not be 1 unit. You know why? Because I already said horizontal distance is 1 unit. And the vertical distance is 1 unit. So the diagonal consecutive points distance will not be 1 unit. Will not, okay? So do not use formula, please. Just use what we sort of used here. So what we use, we used squares and counted area.
Yes.
That same thing, yeah.
First one is, I think, so 2 square units.
Okay, how?
There is a square which is from the midpoint to the right side, and then that is, and there is a triangle from the left till the second point, and this triangle, if you join them together, it will be forming another square. So it will be 2 square units for the first one.
Can you see my tracing when I do this?
Yes, ma'am.
So what you're saying, I'm just repeating it in the like a gesture, computer gesture mode. So this
no.
The entire square. Can you see this?
No, sorry. No.
No, I think you're right.
I think she's talking to someone else, Shweta. You please go ahead.
So this is a full square.
Yes.
And we can like see the square units here. This area we assumed as one square unit. So we are now mathematicians and we only had done one step that we assumed this area as one square unit. So this is one, and this. So this total square will be four, but you can see this is the half of the square. So it will be two square units. That is one way. Other way to see that there is one square unit completely here. And then there is half and half. So the area is two square units. Yeah. One of the teacher is actually showing it by gestures.
Second one is four.
So four. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Three squares and two half triangles.
Huh?
Three squares and two half triangles. So that becomes
blue trapezium. Blue trapezium.
So you are already on blue. Okay. Just wait for a minute. What I was saying that the phrase square units, many people think that it is because the sides are getting squared.
No.
So square units is the square of unit length. So this has four square units. It has four square of unit length. Four square centimeter, it means it has four square of 1 centimeter side. And if I said four square kilometers, it has four squares with one side as 1 kilometer. So that is why. Okay, blue square is one. Who was saying? Blue square is also
the parallelogram is
four, ma'am.
Yeah.
Square units.
So this is one.
Yes, ma'am. This upper one is one. The next one is one, and there is down one triangle, and the side, the corner side, another triangle. When we mix both again, one more square.
So yeah. So 1, 2, 3, and half and half four.
Half and half four.
Okay. What about green rubber band? Oh, sorry, green figure.
Four.
Ma'am also has four.
How did you do it?
It's one, this square unit, and the another square. And upper two halves make third one combined together. And the lower two half triangles will combine together to make fourth. Fourth one.
So when she's saying lower, she's measuring this lower. You cannot measure the elongated square as one. It won't be one. Okay.
Yes, it has to be square.
Because this side is... What is this side? I'll tell you what is the side. This side is not one. This length is not one. But this length is one and this length is one. So this is one square. This is two square. Then she said this is half. This is half. This is half.
Corner two and other sides two.
Yeah. So that is total.
Four.
So let's move on. So this is basically the thing that we have in our maths lab is called geoboard. This is what we use with students.
Yes.
So this is equidistant nails on a wooden board. Most of you have seen it. The distance between this is one and the vertical is one. And therefore, this will be root two. We know that because of the Pythagorean theorem. This is one and this is one. Then this will be square.
Square of the base and height.
Yes. Yeah, so what is the Pythagoras theorem? Side square plus side
Base square plus height square is equal to hypotenuse square.
So one square plus one square, that is two. And we need square root of two to get the exact length. So square. So it's root two. So this is what we do. Students make shapes using rubber bands and they measure area. With rubber bands, it's little more sensory motor, because you can see they can actually make squares, small squares, and measure it. So that is what is happening here. Then we are going to move on to some part of this activity. So take a minute and you have to find areas and just record somewhere all the areas. Don't tell me, but write down A ka area, B ka area, like that. The method that you have been using, all of you, by measuring this half and others is called the triangulation method for finding area. I'll just see that in figure D, what students will do, they will imagine a rectangle here. where there is a slant. And then they know this, ki ye bade rectangle ka, this is half. So the bada rectangle is 2, so this is going to be 1. That is what they will. Anyway, you calculate areas, then we'll move.
Somebody is responding 21.
Sir, your voice was breaking. Can you repeat?
PH, the formula for triangle for that particular part of the.
Say that again. Are you saying Peake's formula or you're saying other?
Yeah, I think he's talking about using some formula for finding the area.
You said half base into height.
Half BH area.
Yeah, don't use that, sir. Don't use that. Assume that you don't know. It's very difficult to assume, but just try to form your justification by actually taking a unit square and measuring, okay? Yeah, don't use formula. So this is what we have been doing here.
Can I attempt something here?
Yes, sir.
For D.
Don't tell me any areas at this moment. Just calculate and tell me when you're done. We will be talking.
Done. I'm done, ma'am.
Done, ma'am.
I like this notation.
If you're done. Okay.
So you have the reactions on your screen. From that reaction, you can either give a thumbs up or yes.
Okay, Sangeeta ma'am gave the reaction. So, and some Saraswati ma'am. Okay, I'll move on.
So I got a 4 thumbs up. I can see in, from on my screen, 5, 3 more. So around 10, 12. Yeah. Yeah, people are giving thumbs up.
I'm going to wait for 10 seconds still.
And where are the reactions?
So on the bottom bar of your screen, you will have security, participants, chat, and then reactions also. Check there.
If it's not there, go to the more.
Yeah, more. Go to more. Yeah.
Okay. So. It's already 3. I'm so sorry. I have one more activity. Anyway, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to run a little fast. So I wanted you to fill in this table. I'll explain you what B and I is. So B is the, this is rubber band on the geo board. So to all the points to which the rubber is touching, that I'm calling as boundary points. And any nails or any points that are inside, I'm calling them as interior points, okay? So you already calculated the form area by repeating the square units. So you know the area for A is 2.5 square units. So I was going to ask you to fill in, but I'm going to do it for you now. So here in the picture, you can see the boundary points are 7 and there are no interior points. So I have written B7, I0 and area 2.5. Can you see that on top right? Yeah. So the next is I filled in the table for you. So what's happening here is I'll go back figure B. There are 8 boundary
points. No interior points.
No interior points and the area is 3.
Three.
So you can give me benefit of doubt that I have done all my math correctly. And this is the table.
Yes, ma'am. So, C is
so in each figure, and these one are the interior boundary points. These
yes.
Are.
Yes.
And you can check your areas here. A is 2.5, B is 3, C is 4.1. Yeah. So these are the areas.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So there is a mathematician called Peake. What he sort of said is a kind of a very powerful thing. He said, if you can bring any shape from the world on a dot grid, on a dot paper, equidistant dots, then you can find the area, any regular shape. It doesn't have to be square and rectangle, any shape that you can draw, that you can make using rubber band on the geoboard, then you can find out the area by using just this formula. So I was going to ask you to come like a derive this formula, but of course we were chatting. So so if you take half of boundary points, then you add interior points and then subtract 1, you are always
correct. Yes, correct.
So if you have a dot sheet with you, or if you give dot sheet to students, you can actually do this activity as where they derive this formula on their own, like a rediscovery. So they take readings, calculate boundary points, find out interior points. And this is the formula that they should be able to come up. So there is two kinds of discussion possible here. One is how to first of all read a pattern and come up with the formula, and second is what formula means, that it has to be applicable for all the cases, because you're in your class, some students will find out some connections like which is only applicable to couple of cases and not all. So there is also an opportunity to discuss what a formula means. So see, this is still not, this is a very generalized formula now, not the formulas like our textbook has for rectangle ke liye alag hai, square ke liye alag hai. So I'm still before formula stage. So I started with repeated measurement. You can initially start with different kinds of unit, not square, like we started triangle or maybe some more easier units. Then I started with square unit and we measured area. Then I got a formula which is applicable for all the shapes. And now I can talk about the specific cases. Ki bhai square ke area ke liye, what will be the generalized formula? Rectangle ke case ke liye, what will be? So it's always going to be length and breadth. So that kind of discussion is, if someone wants to follow this alternative pedagogy, this is a possibility for area which will take care of some of the misconceptions. So Ruchi, how many minutes I have?
Actually, we are overshot the time, but you can go ahead more for five more minutes. Would that be enough,
or would you need more? 3 to 4 minutes, and I am really sorry that I'm
only. No, it's okay. We do overshot time 10 minutes, 15 minutes most of the time. Yeah, it's okay.
So I maybe this next minutes I will not make it interactive, but I will just tell you what I was going to do. So this is a picture of teachers making geoboard and taking to their classes to use it. Yeah. Rubber bands are cheaper. So this is the next part where I wanted to talk about conservation. So one of the things that I have seen with students doing is that if I tell them the area of this paper is X, for example, or let's take 12, X agar pata nahi. And if I like tear this paper and I put it a little bit far from each other, like this. And if I ask them what happened to the area, they will say area is increased. Because they think that it's a formation of a bigger shape. And I think here the sir who mentioned the point about rectangular region and rectangle also matters a lot. Because the area is for this region plus this region for this rectangle. But what they are looking at is a bigger rectangle now. So there are different understanding of students around what happens to area when you add something, you expand something. So this activity is specifically for that. We won't be able to do justice, but I'm just going to tell you. So this is a square you can see, and you can see the scissor sign that you cut those pieces. What's the area of this entire square, the whole big square? If you count the
64 square,
right? Use the formula, it's square of 8. You can now have square of 2 letters.
64.
64
square units. Yes, ma'am. Square.
So this is how it looks like when you cut them and arrange them. So it's paper pieces. Now rearrange these pieces. So you remember I've put on the left, upper left, I've put the original figure. So one idhar aa gaya hai. One ke side mein there is 4. One ke niche 3 and then 2. So this is what has happened. So what's the area of this shape now?
Ma'am, the area remained the same.
Interestingly, but what has happened here?
13. Please count it first.
13.
Is it the same?
13
is it the same?
13 fives are. 65.
So what's happening here?
Here it is increasing.
Increasing.
Area should remain the same. Shweta, what have you done?
Either that, or when some people do it, special people, then the area can increase, isn't it? Authority.
Shweta, kaun sa magic kiya hai?
So that is, I think that is the thing. It's too puzzled that it looks like area has increased and students will be comfortable with this idea. However, when we go a little bit further, we'll see that it's not possible. Because if it is possible, then we don't have to do any other business. We can just bring stuff from market, cut it, rearrange it, and the area is increased. You can bring like a silver patra or gold patra, just cut and rearrange and get richer and richer every day because area is increased.
Same cutted pieces fit into the same, the shape is changed, but the area will remain same.
Area should remain same, but here it looks like the area is increased. And earlier I showed you an example of this kind, where I said the students actually also are looking at the space in between. So something similar is happening here, and let's see what is that, because it's a non-interactive mode now. I'm going to tell you. So when we did this, you see that arrow is showing you the original figure and the later figure. What is happening is that when you do it actually with your hands, you will see those pieces do not match on each other.
Joint pieces.
And in fact, the way you can do is right now, you can take the screenshot of it and calculate the slope of this thing, and you'll see the slope doesn't match. So to things to actually align each other, their slope should be same. Now here it is zero and zero. Therefore, they are going to the exactly horizontal line. So you can also calculate slope and see they will not match. And therefore, there is a gap that we are measuring. And we know that that's what is the area of that gap, which is not the paper. It's one square unit.
Yes.
So 64 is our paper.
Yes.
And beech mein jo hawa add hua hai, that is one square. So let's see how is that added and what is so special with this number. So see the bottom left figure here. I've done with other square, 3x3, same cuts. And when rearranged, you get one parallelogram. If you want to match lines exactly. And that area of that parallelogram is one square.
Unit.
Therefore, initially that square was 3x3, 9 square units. Now it is 5x2, 20 square units lag raha hai, but it is actually because that exactly what the sir had this point, because this is no more area of the rectangle. The region is this and this. And this region is no paper region. It's just a space, which is square unit. Now, interesting thing is it happens only with some special numbers. So to this properties with some special numbers. So you can see 3x3 ke case mein 5x2 bana. 8x8 ke case mein there was 13x5 wala. Yeah. So these numbers are called Fibonacci numbers. And each Fibonacci numbers is very simple thing that you start with 1, 1 basically. And every next number is found by adding previous two. So 2 is addition of these two. 3 is addition of these two. 5 is addition of earlier 2. Okay, like that. Now look at these numbers also. Let's look at 2, 3 and 5. What is the square of 3? 9. And product of 5 and 2? 10. So 3 ka square banega. And if we cut it accordingly to get 5x2, it is going to give you one parallelogram space. Similarly, look at 3, 5, 8. Here it is little different case. What is the square? 25. And the rectangle product is 24. So kam hua hai. So when you cut and make rectangle, you'll say it overlaps. So it doesn't measure one space and it overlaps. I had the picture of that. So see here. So this is 5x5 square. And when I made it into 8x3, there is some overlap. The area is actually reduced. So there is either missing area or adding area that happens in the Fibonacci numbers. Now in this sequence, 5, 8, 13, you already did 64 and 13 5 are 65. And then next will be 8, 13, 21. Wahan pe overlap. So this happens with this special number. So this is that. This I will drop for a moment. I just want you to think as a homework. I want to come back 1 minute for area, but just think of a homework as, let's take consecutive numbers, 3, 4, 5. And same thing happens. Square of 4 is 16 and minus 1 gets you 3 into 5. So can we make missing area puzzles using these dimensions? So this is for you to try. If you have understood whatever has happened so far, that using Fibonacci numbers, we could make missing area puzzles. So can we use consecutive natural numbers to make missing area puzzles? That is the question. And just going back to area, what I want to say is that one of the major challenges of area is to understand the idea of unit and its relation to the measurement. And for the conservation, you need to create a conflict. The area is going to remain same. And that is what, in a very brief presentation, of course, this is not entire discussion of area. It's a complicated area. And I hope you guys will think and you will meet Ruchi and some of us again and again to learn more about this. And we will also see how from classroom, different student conceptions can be used in research to understand more about this. So, yeah. I want to thank Department of Atomic Energy for the grant. And this is where I use the shapes for 4 slides, the block. And the second website is the Math Education website, where all these activities with descriptions are given. So you could download those, Marathi and English. This is how our math, this is the address that you need basically. So take a screenshot of this slide. You have a lot of resources there. Yeah. You have textbooks, you have MATLAB activities. We have around 100 activities there. Some material, videos of teachers, even some videos from Ruchi's work.
Yeah, so I would really encourage you to go to this website, look at the different resources that are present there. I would definitely suggest you to watch these videos. There are very interesting strategies to work with students. Maybe you can adapt them for online teaching learning also. And in terms of resources, I think mathematics posters that have been developed by the HBCSC Math Lab is something which has been widely appreciated, and you should definitely have a look at it. Maybe you can use it in some very interesting manner.
Yeah.
In fact, I mean, I want to just add about the Tangram, which is, I also learned about Tangram at HBCSC Math Lab itself. So there are lots of resources. Please go and visit, and definitely you will learn a lot from there.
Yeah, so thank you. And apologies for the speedy end.
No way. So I think we all enjoyed and were fully engaged in your session. We really want to thank you a lot from the depth of our heart for taking this session for us, and we really, really enjoyed it. I just want all of you to just stay back a little and fill up the feedback form. I'll share the feedback form link right now in the chat itself. If anybody has any questions or any further comments you want to make, please feel free to do so. I'll just post the link of the feedback form. We will also be releasing this video on our YouTube channel for Center for Excellence in Teacher Education on YouTube itself. So please, if you want to see the video, you can later on go and access CETE YouTube channel and can see it. Any questions you have? Any further questions?
Ma'am, it would be really helpful if you have a continuation session of this one once again.
So what do you say, Shweta? So we will...
To move more deeper into area measurement, or you have another topic in mind?
Yes. Okay, what do you, if you want to have a continuation session, what is it that you exactly want to discuss in that? Do you want area itself, or do you want some other topic related to mathematics?
No, as ma'am said, na, that I had to hurry, and certain activities were not, also couldn't get hold of that. So it would be really, ma'am, very helpful for us if you could be kind enough to extend it one more session.
Thank you, Hashima. I think I will talk to Ruchi and see what should be most relevant.
Yeah.
And more deeper understanding of area measurement. Yeah, I'll talk. Thank you for the suggestion.
Yeah, we will definitely discuss that, and we'll let you know any further opportunities if we have. So I'm pasting the feedback form here in the chat. You can see the link.
Yes.
Please click on it and please fill it up. It is very important for us to get this feedback from all of you, because we do consider it for our deciding our further sessions, the topics that you might be interested in, anything that you want to take forward. For example, we were thinking of having either a group on Telegram or on WhatsApp.
Ma'am, it says you need permission.
Permission. Okay, just hold on. I'll check that. Just wait 1 minute.
The form is not open for responses, I think.
Okay. Just wait. I think I clicked something by mistake. I'm sharing the link again. I'll share it again. Yeah. Please try now. See if it is opening.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Opening now?
Yes,
please fill it up.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I was saying that we were thinking of having either a group on Telegram or on WhatsApp. For example, if there are so many people who are interested in mathematics education, and you have been coming to our School Synergy workshop series for a multiple number of times, it would help if we have this group and where we can continue our conversation even after the session itself. Because the online session is for 1 hour. And for ease and convenience, we have kept it to 1 hour because people find it a convenient time to take out and come for it. But if you have further questions or you want to know more resources, you have tried out something in your classrooms from this session and you want to share with us how it went or any challenges that you face. So in that sense, that Telegram group or WhatsApp group would be useful for us to take the discussion further from what we have discussed in the session itself. So I have also included this question in the feedback form from this session onward. So if you are interested, please let us know in the feedback form itself. And whenever we will establish that group, we will contact you because you will be giving your phone number. So we will add you in that group if you say yes to that. Okay, do let us know if you will be interested in something like that or not. So we are also thinking of having a kind of a badge giving criteria, like if people have attended 3 or 4 of the seminars, then they can earn a badge. And if they have collected several of these badges, then perhaps they can get a certificate, because many people have been requesting for certificates, but it is, we believe that we are not going to give a certificate for attending just one session, but a sustained engagement over several sessions definitely, qualifies for a certificate. So we are in the process of developing some sort of criteria so that in the further coming sessions, perhaps you can account for whatever sessions you have attended. And if you have attended a lot, and you have responded on some Google form about your own experience of using those ideas, perhaps then you can get a certificate from that. Yeah, so Shweta, you can leave if you want. I'll just be here sitting silently for a few minutes so that if you have any issues with the feedback form, you can let me know. I'll just be here.
Thank you, Ruchi.
So once you have filled the feedback form, you can, or even if you have clicked it open, you are filling it up, you can leave the meeting if you want.
Thanks, Ruchi. Thank you for the opportunity. I enjoyed
it. Thanks, Shweta. Thanks.
Bye.
Bye.
Ruchi, ma'am, this is Ram here.
Yeah, Goli.
Regarding the continuation of this topic, I was just wondering if it's possible to take this in a different way, in the sense that we have seen the topic as such, but if we can look at it, how the child understands it. When we look at the area in terms of, say, centimeter square, we take a unit square. But when you move on to a rectangle, how can we, can I fit 25 rectangles to make, 25 squares to make a triangle, or say 30 squares to make a circle.
Yeah.
In triangle, I can always cut the square and maybe fit it here and there. But how does a child understand this concept of unit square being used to explain the concept of area?
Area. Yeah. I thank you, Ram. That is a excellent, excellent point that you're making, because I think we do need to delve into that aspect also. One of my colleagues is also looking into this aspect itself of how students understand area and how the unit square, whether it helps or how it helps in understanding the concept of area itself. So yes, that is a good area for us to delve forward into. And since we have so many teachers here, it would be a good idea for whatever ideas that were discussed today, if they can try it out with their students in the classroom in the online or face-to-face classroom and can get back to us and share their experience, then also it would be a good learning experience. In terms of child's understanding of area, there can be different sources. The textbook can be sources. The classroom pedagogy can be a source. There can be several conceptions arising from different kinds of interactions that the child might have in their environment itself or with their other peers or elders. So all those things can have an influence on how students understand the concept of area. And if we do some sort of intervention with it, with some children, then we can perhaps understand more deeply about it. Shweta, you wanted to say something? Sorry. Go ahead, Ram.
Yeah, also maybe the language, the words, the terminology that we use to explain it. So when it comes to English, we explain it in certain way. When it goes to regional languages, we do it in certain ways. So if we can also, you know, keep a small focus, a little focus on how we can use certain words and how we can avoid certain words to increase clarity and avoid confusion, that will also be great, because I think you have the experience of working with the topic and with a variety of schools and teachers. So that would really help us help teachers in the classroom on the ground.
Definitely, definitely. It would require just one more session for us to delve into it. So yes, we will definitely look at it.
Thank you.
Yeah. So if you have filled up the feedback form, you can sign off from the meeting. If there are any issues that people are facing in filling the feedback form, please let me know here itself.
Thank you for such a lovely and informative session. Thanks a lot, and looking forward for much more.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm going to stop the recording.